short period, yet sometimes even a short time span can make a world of difference, as it has done in Chanderi. Chanderi is a small municipality of Ashoknagar district in Madhya Pradesh. It has a population of just over 40,000, 40% of whom are illiterate. The nearest railway station is 45 kilometers away. There is no ATM facility and electricity for only 6 hours every day. A traditional weaving cluster is the main source of income for Chanderi. Here, 3,500 weaving families create the famous Chanderi saris. These generate an annual revenue of $10 million. However, the average income of a weaver is only $50 per month. Before 2010, there was no computer penetration and 100% computer illiteracy in Chanderi. In 2010, a digital design resource center called Chanderi Young was set up. It was like a drop in a pool. After that, there was no looking back. By 2011, computer training centers were opened. Ordinary households, hotels, and offices installed computers.
Initially, we learned how to start and shut down computers. Now, my 8-year-old son operates a computer freely and frequently.
We need lots of design resources. We also search market to sell our products. Through internet, now we have access to enormous design archives, access to markets, and opportunity to exploit a wider consumer base.
Through the efforts of Chanderi Young, computer knowledge and literacy has spread rapidly. The internet has exposed the world to the citizens of Chanderi. By 2013, there were over 50 households with Wi-Fi connections. We boast Wi-Fi internet connections. Even a couple of mothers as now have internet connections and computer labs. The weavers of Chanderi are taking their centuries-old craft to the world through e-commerce and Facebook. It is just the beginning, but the beginning has taken deep roots.
So Chanderi was our first site under the Wireless for Communities project. We started this off in October 2010. We had some help from the Nepal Wireless Project, so we had our friends from Nepal help us out, who've of course done some great work up in the Himalayas. Shahid was of course in the first batch that we got together. Osama was there, I was there as well. We spent a few days in Chanderi. The rest of the team spent, I think, close to a week, week and a half maybe, training, installing, deploying, scaling hills at nightfall. Yeah, I remember him quite well. So, and you know, what we've seen it over the last 3 years, this project has just slowly evolved organically. It's grown. You know, as you heard, schools are connected, the madrasas are connected, e-commerce sites are up and running, things are being sold and bought. I mean, it's been transformational at the grassroots level. And this is what, you know, we're really proud at the Internet Society and DEF, and of course Ford Foundation, who's joined a different location on a similar basis. I should highlight here that, you know, this is now an award-winning project. Last month, we won the ITU Award for Broadband for Communities, but that's not the only one. We've been shortlisted for the Public Affairs Asia Gold Standard Award. The announcement will be tomorrow. So just even making the shortlist is an achievement. Whether we win or not, we've already won, as far as I'm concerned. So, you know, in the space of 1 month, we've had 2 international sets of recognition for the project. So that means we're doing something right. And it's not us saying it, it's the world saying, telling us that you've done something right. So the question is now, how do we take this to the next step? We've seen the impact it has on people. You know, we've got all the regulatory and policy issues. Technology is never a problem. You know, anyone who's worked in technology always knows technology is never a problem. It's the policy and the regulatory issues which sometimes hold us back. So what I would like our esteemed panelists and our practitioners from the field, and sir, we would also appreciate your comments. You know, how do we move this forward? You know, some of the issues have been highlighted by Professor Jain. I think she summarized it pretty well, as well as Shahid, in terms of the challenges he faced. But what I would like a small discussion, you know, for the next, let's say, 20 minutes is, you know, how do we, where do we go from here? What are the concrete steps we need to take? You know, if there's some issues with government agencies, you know, in 60 days, if it hasn't been granted, deemed approved, how do we try and enforce that or create more awareness around that? TV white space is something that's emerging globally as something that we should be making use of since we moved to a digital channel. My other home country is Australia, so we've just moved to digital TV. In fact, the last one just got switched off recently in the area that my house is. And before I go to the panel, I just want to give you one other little piece of information about Australia. So Australia, similarly to India, sir, has had the NBN program running, for the National Broadband Network, very similar in principle to what sir is doing with his BBNL. The interesting thing about the Australian project was that it was completely politically driven, if you like. The previous government, we just got voted out a couple of months ago, had promised that we would have fiber to the home. The incoming government said, no, we'll go fiber to the node, and we'll use either ADSL or wireless or whatever for that last mile access. And last election, which was 4 years ago, this became a major election issue, so much so that the party who was saying we'll go fiber to the node lost the election. Unfortunately, this time around, they've come back in, not due to the broadband issues, but due to some other issues in the country. But the issue now is they've pretty much put the project on hold. It's a $40 billion project. It's a massive project. Australia is a very large country, as you know. It's bigger than the continental US, right, in terms of its size. Dispersed populations, yes, it's a very rich country. There's no doubt about that. But the dispersed populations that we have in Australia is, you know, sometimes you can go for 100 kilometers, you may only see one kangaroo. And maybe the next 100 kilometers later, you'll see one person driving somewhere or to a farm or something. So it's a very, I mean, you though studied there as well, so that's why he's smiling away. So, you know, it's a vast country with very few people. The amount of people you have in Greater Delhi is the whole of Australia. Right? So that's a perspective you have, right? So the issue now is that the project's been pretty much put on hold until there's a review by the incoming government on what we're going to do. Are we going to go fiber to the node, fiber to the home, or something else completely? So the point I was trying to make here is that, you know, sometimes with the best of intentions, political will becomes a problem as well. And this is not at the bureaucratic level, but this is at the actual politician level, you know, what they promised in the elections and whatnot. So with that, I'd like to hand back to our panelists and our practitioners. And I would really like to have some concrete suggestions and proposals, perhaps, on where do we go from here. Professor Jain, would you like to start?
Well, I thought I was the summarizer. Anyway, I think one of the things I've been feeling is the village internet availability is very much dependent on communities and for proliferation, etc. But in the way the government is looking at it, it is more like, okay, we are giving the infrastructure, but that's the hardware. We also need the softer ware, which is about solving these problems, about content, how do we make it available, how do we make it accessible. It's all right, village people can create their own content, but we need a lot of content is driven by their needs of using government resources, you know. So how do we make that content available? We, you know, you were saying Department of Education and Health will drive it. I'm not sure that it'll happen very fast, because they have their own policies, programs and all, and I'm not sure if that is the thing. For example, you know, MHRD has digitized so many books and so many textbooks and courses and material. How many people know about it? And how do they access it? And so on. So to me, if we can we in USOF, you know, have these multi-stakeholders committees which will look at this and actually put effort into doing this, because they, we really need to work with the community. So far we are working with DOT or with a set of DIT or, you know, few people. So I would really like to see that happening. And if it can be possible, we'd be happy to contribute in some way if some help is required, if at all. And I think DOT and TRAI need to look at this cost of domestic bandwidth, which is very important for not only rural communities, but also for internet per se in India. And I think our, once internet is more accessible throughout India, also to rural communities, it'll become easier. So to me, these are the two important things. And of course, making more spectrum delicensed at a faster rate. I even though I'm not young as these people are, but I don't have the patience to wait for all this. So I'm sure these people have much less patience than I have.
Thank you. So the reason I asked the professor to go first was because hopefully she would lay the framework for whatever else other people thought needed to be done. So, sir, did you have?
A number of points have been mentioned during the course of this interactions. I would like to take a few of them to see how best I can address them. Shahid Ahmed had spoken about common processes. आपके बात से सहमत हूँ and सरलीकरण की बहुत गुंजाइश है. तो मैं समझता हूँ सरलीकरण ने केवल एक कार्यालय में अनेक कार्यालय में जो करने की आवश्यकता है. और हम लोगों का ये उद्देश्य भी है कि आईसीटी के जरिए जो है सरलीकरण का प्रकोप आएगा. I do hope that the WPC will be able to look at that SACFA clearance issue, which is one of the things specific to your office, which is every office has its own challenges. जहाँ तक टावर का निर्माण करके उसको इस्तेमाल करके और डिस्ट्रीब्यूट, प्रोफेसर जैन definitely mentioned about the Information Technology Act and उसके प्राविधानों का उल्लेख किया. So I think all of us need to know that हर एक संस्था की अपनी अपनी limitations होती है. ISP license होना ज़रूरी है ताकि सेवाएं प्रदान कर सकते. मतलब हर कोई जो है इंटरनेट उपलब्ध नहीं कर सकता है. जैसे केबल टीवी का भी जो है वो MSO से ले करके वो फीड करते हैं, then they are charging you and doing. मैं यही समझता हूँ कि अगर इसे, मैं हमेशा ये मानता हूँ, कपड़ा हो या बैंडविड्थ हो, मतलब होलसेलर डिस्ट्रीब्यूटर रिटेलर, ये व्यवस्था होना ज़रूरी है. तो जब तक ये व्यवस्था नहीं है तब तक ग्राहक के लिए बड़ी कठिनाई है. आई एम ऑफ दैट फंडामेंटल प्रिंसिपल. एंड मैं खुद ये मानता हूँ कि जो केबल टीवी का जो प्रकोप पिछले 20 वर्षों से हुआ है, हम तो खाली एक केबल टीवी ऑपरेटर से संपर्क करते हैं, 200 या 250 रुपया देते हैं, और जैसे विभास जी ने कहा था, हमें कभी दिक्कत नहीं होती है, खाली एक मोबाइल नंबर दिया जाता है, वो संपर्क करें, कहीं कनेक्शन टूट जाता है बारिश के दिन या कभी, तो वो जो है तुरंत उसको ठीक कर. आई थिंक मेरे ख्याल से उसी प्रकार की व्यवस्था इंटरनेट में भी आने की ज़रूरत, और वो तभी संभव है जब ये होलसेलर डिस्ट्रीब्यूटर रिटेलर की जो मॉडल है वो कायम हो. और तभी कायम हो सकता है जब आपके ब्रॉडबैंड के जो डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन है वो भी टेलीकॉम सर्विस प्रोवाइडर, इंटरनेट सर्विस प्रोवाइडर और नीचे डिजिटल सर्विस प्रोवाइडर केबल ऑपरेटर के जरिए हो. यही मॉडल काम करेगा और मैं इस मॉडल पर अपना जो है दृढ़ विश्वास रखता हूँ कि यही मॉडल आगे काम करेगा. सरलीकरण की आवश्यकता है. नेशनल टेलीकॉम पॉलिसी के जरिए जो है यूनिफाइड लाइसेंस इत्यादि इत्यादि आ रहा है. और मैं मानता हूँ कि ब्रॉडबैंड का अगर फैलाव होना है तो ये मॉडल के जरिए या ये या अन्य कोई मॉडल जो भी हो, मतलब उसी के जरिए हो सकता है. दूसरी बात है कि किस प्रकार यूएसओ का प्रयोग हो सकता है। मैं यहाँ मानना चाहता हूँ कि यूएसओ ने अपना एक दायित्व निर्वहन कर रहा है कि रूरल एरियाज में अवस्थापना का सृजन। क्या यूएसओएफ उससे अधिक बहुत सारे अन्य कार्य को अपना दायित्व माने, क्योंकि जब कोई और विभाग कर रहा है या कोई और संस्था कर रहा है, क्या ये यूएसओएफ के कार्य क्षेत्र में आता है? एक प्रश्न होता है। हालांकि हमारी आकांक्षा होती है जो कार्य कर रहा है उससे जो और थोड़ा काम ले लिया जाए, यही है, इसमें कोई वाद विवाद नहीं है। पर मैं समझता हूँ कि जो ब्रॉडबैंड के फैलाव के लिए खुद मानता हूँ कि 5C सिंड्रोम, कनेक्टिविटी, कॉस्ट ऑफ डिवाइसेस, कॉम्पिटिटिव टैरिफ, कंटेंट, कंप्यूटर लिटरेसी। कनेक्टिविटी यूएसओएफ का दायित्व, कॉस्ट ऑफ डिवाइसेस हमारे इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स विभाग का और इंडस्ट्री का, ताकि हमारे हाथ में जो है, जैसे स्मार्टफोन्स 2-3 हज़ार रुपये में क्यों नहीं आ जाए, तो तब तो जो है पिकअप हो जाएगी अपने आप। आज 5 हज़ार के ऊपर है या 6-7 हज़ार के ऊपर है, तो अगर सस्ता हो जाए तो जो है बहुत लोग उसको खरीदेंगे स्मार्टफोन। दूसरी बात है, प्रोफेसर जैन ने कहा था कंटेंट, हाँ कंटेंट आईटी विभाग की दायित्व। आईटी विभाग में भी मैं समझता हूँ प्राइवेट सेक्टर में जो आईटी के जगत में कार्य कर रहे हैं, जो सॉफ्टवेयर वगैरह बना रहे हैं, जिस प्रकार हमारे एंटरटेनमेंट इंडस्ट्री का जो है एक बड़ा नाम है, उसी तरफ जो एंटरटेनमेंट इंडस्ट्री का अनुभव है, उसी अनुभव को हम क्यों न जो है कंटेंट में, डिजिटल कंटेंट में लाए। क्योंकि वो यूट्यूब या क्या कुछ नहीं है, वो तो एक वीडियो है और वीडियो के जरिए उपलब्ध होता है। तो इट इज़ बेसिकली ट्राइंग टू गेट कंटेंट इन मल्टीलिंगुअल थिंग। और जो टेक्स्ट होता है वो सबसे ज़्यादा बोरिंग होता है। किसी बच्चे को किताब दे दे, वो वैसे ही 15 मिनट में सो जाता है। और यदि इसी टेक्स्ट को हम वीडियो, ऑडियो, एनिमेशन एंड गेमिंग, इन अलग अलग फॉर्मेट में लाएं, तो उसका एक आकर्षण होता है और रिसेप्टिविटी, माइंड की रिसेप्टिविटी भी और बेहतर होती है। मैं समझता हूँ कि जिस तरीके से सिनेमा ने हम लोगों के जीवन को काफ़ी मजबूत किया है, एनिमेशन, गेमिंग, वीडियो एंड ऑडियो शुड बी द वे इन विच डिजिटल कंटेंट शुड फ्लो टू ऑडियंसेस। आई थिंक दैट शुड बी द ऑर्डर ऑफ द डे। ई लर्निंग शुड बी इन दैट पर्टिकुलर मोड। दैट इज वाई यूट्यूब इज पॉपुलर। यूट्यूब इज पॉपुलर, इट इज नथिंग बट सम विजुअल्स विच इज जस्ट पुट ऑन द ट्यूब, दैट्स इट। सो यू हैव टू मेक। थर्ड थिंग दैट आई फील इज competitive tariff. Professor Jain had touched upon that. How we will bring down broadband prices. अच्छा, मैं content के बारे में जब बात करता हूँ, मैं एक और चीज़ कहना चाहता हूँ। Telecom service providers के बारे में भी मेरा प्रश्न उनके लिए भी है। क्यों आप जिस तरीके से voice में growth देके हैं, data में नहीं कर पा रहे? और उनके लिए भी मेरा यही संदेश है, आप होलसेलर, डिस्ट्रीब्यूटर, रिटेलर मॉडल को अपनाएं। अनलेस एंड अंटिल यू आर एबल टू शेयर रेवेन्यू विद कंटेंट प्रोवाइडर्स, यू आर नॉट गोइंग टू ग्रो। वॉइस सेगमेंट में का पूरा उनके रेवेन्यू उनके हाथ में है, बट डेटा सेगमेंट में न वो कस्टमर के करीब है जो सर्विस कर सके, न उनके पास कंटेंट। कंटेंट को लेकर के कस्टमर तक पहुंचना के लिए यू नीड ए न्यू बिजनेस मॉडल विच इज शेयरिंग रेवेन्यू। अनलेस यू शेयर रेवेन्यू यू कैनॉट ग्रो। सो दिस आई थिंक इज व्हाट आई वुड से मैसेज टू द टेलीकॉम सर्विस प्रोवाइडर्स, प्लीज लर्न टू शेयर द पाई। पाई इज गोइंग टू ग्रो बिगर, बट अनलेस यू लर्न टू शेयर द पाई यू कैनॉट। कॉम्पिटिटिव टैरिफ इज नेसेसरी, आई एग्री। ब्रॉडबैंड आज के युग में जिस तरीके से हम वॉइस के लिए सबसे सस्ते दर देते हैं दुनिया भर, जब तक वही इतिहास जो है डाटा सेक्टर में नहीं आए, शायद हमारे देश में ब्रॉडबैंड की ग्रोथ नहीं हो। एंड आई थिंक ट्राई एंड डिवोटली ऑल हैव टू वर्क टू सी दैट ब्रॉडबैंड प्राइसेस कम डाउन टू अफोर्डेबल लेवल्स। हिंदुस्तान में तो आदमी बहुत ही प्राइस सेंसिटिव है, वो एड भी आता है आजकल कितना देता है, दैट गिव्स अ क्लियर थिंग मैसेज हाउ प्राइस सेंसिटिव वी आर। सो वी मस्ट लुक एट इट दिस वे दैट प्राइस इज द डिटर्मिनेंट ऑफ ग्रोथ। यूटिलिटी द मार्केट विल फाइंड व्हाट इट्स यूटिलिटी। आप चाहे जितना विज्ञापन दें, जब तक उनके लिए सस्ता नहीं हो, नो वन इज गोइंग टू डू इट, दैट इज गोइंग टू बी। एंड कंप्यूटर लिटरेसी इज अनदर फाइनल सी दैट आई लुक एट इट। सम पीपल से द सिक्स्थ सी इज कन्वर्जेंस, सो आई एग्री ऑन दैट, बट आई एम ट्राइंग टू bring this all into the thing कि इस पूरे ब्रॉडबैंड मैं कहूँगा ecosystem, इस वातावरण में हमें बहुत सारे reforms की भी ज़रूरत है। rural ISPs का आना नितांत आवश्यक। I personally am of that particular opinion and I personally feel क्यों ना जो रिटेलर की कॉन्सेप्ट है, वो गांव में जब भारत ब्रॉडबैंड आ जाएगा तो पंचायत में आएगा, पंचायत में से रूरल आईएसपी है तो वो डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करे। सो देन इट इज़ अ क्वेश्चन ऑफ रेवेन्यू शेयरिंग बिटवीन द रूरल आईएसपी एंड द नाउ आई पर्सनली लुक एट इट दिस वे, BBNL हैज फोर्स टू एंटर इनटू दिस एक्टिविटी बिकॉज द प्राइवेट सेक्टर हैज नॉट कम, अदरवाइज BBNL वॉज ओरिजिनली thought of only as a bulk bandwidth provider. And I would like to keep that as the original model, but this is driven by compulsion and government user model, etc. So, main samajhta hoon ki jaise jaise hum log is network ko roll out karenge, anek cheezon ko jo hai chunautiyon ko sambhalne ki zarurat hai. And I think we will have to rise to the occasion. Government cannot back out. This is what I am trying to say. एक कहावत है दैट गवर्नमेंट वर्क्स बेस्ट विच गवर्न्स लीस्ट, बट हिंदुस्तान में तो ये कहते हैं कि सरकार ने कुछ नहीं किया। तो शायद अहमद साहब फिर कहेंगे कि और बहुत सारे जो है फॉर्म वार्म भरना पड़ता है, हम भी जो है उससे पीड़ित हैं या नहीं कि, बट द पॉइंट ऑफ द मैटर इज ऑल ऑफ अस एक्सपेक्ट गवर्नमेंट हैज टू डू इट।
सर, वन ऑफ द possible ways for the future, in the very near future, is to see where would you encourage pilots with BBNL? Where do you see the sites as possibilities? So if you would share the states where you're planning to roll out first and where you would encourage the pilots by rural ISPs, so that's one question. Second is, I think that I want to acknowledge people like Shahid and also you, of course, as, you know, this kind of rural engineers. And so I think there's a this is a nice opportunity to perhaps create more technical training for a cadre of technicians, you know, and engineers at that level. And I also want to point out that one of the concessions that we should have is looking at this infrastructure as being completely essential to the actualization of other plans. Jaise national e-governance plan hai, usme pragya kendra hote hain. तो प्रज्ञा कॉमन सर्विस सेंटर्स विच आर मेंट टू बी दीज काइंड ऑफ नॉलेज हब्स फॉर सीमेंटिंग वेरियस काइंड ऑफ नॉलेज, बट अगर हम ओरमांझी डिस्ट्रिक्ट में जहाँ पर हमारा ब्लॉक में जहाँ झारखंड में अगर वहाँ जाएंगे तो यू विल फाइंड दैट दे आर नॉट ऑपरेशनल फॉर वेरियस रीजंस। सो हाउ डू वी मेक द दिस टाइप ऑफ मॉनिटरिंग एसेंशियल सो दैट वी कैन देन डिमांड for more broadband infrastructure? I think that's very, very useful. And if, even if you look at, say, government schools, there is a requirement for government schools and colleges to only get their broadband, as far as I understood, from BSNL. So
if it is only BSNL that can provide this, then it should be providing it. You know, so do we have better monitoring agencies, or do we say, can BSNL, to achieve its goals, also share infrastructure? And if it's so, instead of getting rid of BSNL or saying it's horrible, I think that is something. There's a common frustration with BSNL. Can we say you can? This is a model for you to be more operational. You know, so the point is, how do we make collaborations? I think this is going to be a game of collaboration, and no big player can wipe out the small player. That ship has sailed, and we have failed at that. We need the small players, and that's the plea I will make for that.
Can I? I'll just come from the perspective of a village-level entrepreneur now. So when we do the rural internet service business, and let's assume there are 50 customers, 50 customers humare ko chalane, the average investment a guy does is about 2,50,000 rupees to get cracking on this model in a realistic manner, and you'll agree with me. This is the kind of expense which you have. And parallelly, when you deploy this network, you, with an ARPU of about 600 rupees, you nearly scratch through on that model. The submission which I have is that this is infrastructure, the cost, the customer premises equipment and the infrastructure to make a Wi-Fi ready house is 3,000 rupees. And it needs to be scaled down with the intervention of the Department of Electronics for sure. But can there be funding for these village level entrepreneurs in the value chain of the national broadband network? And where do people like me go? We've left good jobs to bring out this. But when you go to a SIDBI and you ask for funding, he says you don't have a balance sheet for 3 years. So if I have a vision of doing, say, 50 villages, speed of time, addressing the market, bringing people online, Google has got a campaign, get people online. How do they go online? Because entrepreneurs like me also face that bottleneck of the right funding, whereas we are playing in the domain of infrastructure. And the 6 C's which you mentioned, actually, I've noted down, they're very valid C's. But somehow, that support is not coming from whichever ecosystem, because either they're too risk averse. We know that broadband is going to grow, content is going to rule, ARPUs are going to go high. But still, it's kind of a vacuum which is around the overall ecosystem.
I'd just like to respond to what Vikas mentioned and Dr. Agarwal mentioned. Two things. One is that what USOF can do, and you're also mentioned few other bottom of the pyramid type of structures. Let me try and get this thing clear. A, the common service centers, of which about 1 lakh+ have been rolled out, we are trying to engage with the common service center forum to see, can they try and co-locate closer to the Gram Panchayat, so that as our terminal comes and you have high-speed broadband, they are immediately the beneficiaries of that broadband. So this is in Rajasthan, because they have the Rajiv Gandhi IT Kendras. So I think since the Nofun terminal is located there, I think the Rajasthan government has also decided that the CSCs can be co-located. But variations are there across the state. Second, where can you try out? We have done 3 pilot projects in Ajmer in Rajasthan, in Vishakhapatnam, Parwada, and also in North Tripura. DEF is working alongside Intel. They have set up what is known as Follow the Fiber, and they have a digital literacy mission activity in this 3 pilot location. Anyone who wishes, in fact, I've been trying to engage with a lot of MSOs, providing free bandwidth for a period of time till December. In fact, I plan to extend it till March, so that more and more people can come hook on and see what applications are possible. This is where I think, I've been trying to talk to Ortel to do something in Vishakhapatnam, because they are based in Orissa somewhere. So all of these are efforts, but at the end of the day, the traction will have to come from the private sector. See, the government can lead the way in the investment, but it's not possible for the government to fund customer premises equipment. I'd like to mention, when the pilots were completed in October 2012, there was no response from the telecom sector. The Department of IT pitched in to say, since you have laid the infrastructure, now out of the NEGP, we will try to do something. And 195 locations in these three pilot locations, blocks, they have taken connectivity from BSNL and customer premises equipment provided in government panchayat, government schools, government hospitals or primary health center, and government offices. Now, it's not possible for them to do it in private institution. And they are trying to work out a business model out of the three pilot. Point I'm trying to emphasize is, Sarkar ek vibhag se telecom infrastructure le kar raha hai. Sarkar dusri vibhag se IT infrastructure de raha hai aur Sarkar ki sansadhan simit hai. So Sarkar cannot replicate the pilot experiment across the country. So there has to be disruptive business model that will have to emerge. That's why I think this whole business of CSC is trying to co-locate. Because even if you look at this, the CSC is also out of a government project. It's been viability gap, etc. So it's, you cannot scale it up providing everything. Yeah. And the other point is for content development. I think there are so many other institutions doing it, like the MHRD, school education, college education, IT department. So telecom department, USO will like to focus on the infra. That's
obviously, NOFL or USO should not focus on that.
Yes.
Not
we should just look on, yes, on the infra.
So just on the customer premises equipment you mentioned, I recall a few years back, USO fund actually used to subsidize the computer for the rural broadband plan at that point of time. And I was thinking it might be possible, may not be to that extent, maybe now because the prices have come down, things like that, but subject to usage. And especially I would suggest that have some sort of subsidy in the rural areas, which is not a one-time subsidy, but which is more, which is along the way. So that way what happens is it's not just a one-time that you give, somebody buys something and whether he or she uses it or not, but have something which is more on an ongoing basis. That might be worth considering.
That is the scheme which Professor Jain is also aware, Rural Wireline Broadband Scheme,
yeah.
Where I am
done an evaluation.
Yeah. Somehow the way in which BSNL has implemented has not been very satisfactory.
Yeah.
I would be very candid about it. Target was that in each of the 28,000 rural exchanges, about 31 connections were to be given. Almost 8,88,832 connections were to be given. I think as on date, only 5.35 lakhs, and the scheme is ending in January 2014.
See, I think also from that evaluation scheme, evaluation study that we did, what was one thing that was obvious was that obviously the people who are in R1, R2 category will take up this because they are better off. But therefore, the implication of that is for us is that subsidy that we are giving to them should only be for an adoption period. And it should be linked to how much they use it later. And then the subsidy can be spread out to other people as well.
So we have one comment from the audience. I'll just bring him in. Yeah.
I'm Chintan Raj. I'm a Prime Minister's Fellow with the Ministry of Rural Development. Just a quick comment. Vibhas, you spoke of village level entrepreneur assistance. Generally what happens at the grassroots level is there's a problem of too much of silos and no convergence. So to give you an example, to fund a village level entrepreneur for setting up a rural wireless ISP, the capital cost to set up the tower could be met from something known as the integrated action plan that runs from the Department of Planning. Because for example, we are trying to do that in rural Bihar using the IAP funds. And why so? Because at the end of the day, even the intranet is very important that gets formed, because the government, every scheme of the government, Let's take, for example, the Nirmal Bharat Abhiyan under the Drinking Water Sanitation Ministry or Narega under the other Ministry of Rural Development. All of them need to do a lot of information, education, communication. For that, intranet is very essential because nowadays direct information transfer is also becoming important. Hence, that is a very good investment which the government can make using the IAP. Using something known as a Prime Minister's Employment Generation Program, your VLE can apply to the Department of Industries and get a 35% subsidy to set up his services center or whatever his ISP requirements in addition to the Tawara. And finally, in Bihar, under the 4th Finance Commission of the state, we are distributing free computers. I mean, we are giving a budget to all the panchayats to invest in computers and all other associated equipment. So basically, the problem is about silos and lack of convergence at the grassroots level. It's all available at the grassroots level. Yeah, thank you. And just out of context, but wherever the panchayats have actually invested in the computer equipment, it's out of force from the top because the fund has been given to them and they don't know what to do with it. And like they say, chuhe hamara wo wire kaat rahe. And hence, coming to Ms. Agarwal's point on the whole aspect of soft intervention, the whole pull has to be created from the civil society. The pull in terms of what Shahid has been doing at the grassroots level, the push can be provided by the government, the computer can be provided. Yeah, thank you for the opportunity.
Thanks.
I want to quite quickly highlight one, sir. I don't know if this has come to your attention, about the one of the issues around placing the CSCs in the Gram Panchayat premises is there is a gender gap in that. And this is what I observed in Jharkhand, where all the women who were in charge, who had taken the CSC license, they were not feeling safe and they were not comfortable. Of course, there's a law and security problem in Jharkhand in any case. And they had all tried to move it to their houses where they were without electricity. And therefore, it was self-defeating because it didn't happen. So I'm just trying to, if we can have more gender-friendly spaces and if the panchayat itself could be made a gender-friendly space, I think the Yusuf would have a good contribution towards that exercise. Anyway, it's such a male-dominated field. I think we need more women in it.
I
so.
Think,
So any final comments from you before we wrap it up? So any final comments from our panelists? I can allow you 140 characters each. No? Okay. So thank you very much to our panelists, to our practitioners, to our audience, and to Sir for joining us for this session. We appreciate your time. I think in the last half an hour, we had some interesting discussions and suggestions and recommendations. I'm hoping that our team who's archiving all this will create a nice little document for us. What I would suggest is that then we circulate it to the panelists and as well as our practitioners for your comments before we finalize the publication. So Chitra, could you make a note of that and ensure that happens? Okay. So again, thank you very much for your attendance and for your interaction and your contribution. And have a great rest of the month and award. Thank you.
Yeah. I would like to
thanks, Rajneesh, and thanks to all the participants.
Yeah, thanks. I would like to request our chair to honor these panelists also with the token of appreciation. Thank you, sir. And I would also like to thank you, our chair and our moderator. Yeah. Thanks a lot.